Thanks for joining us again. My name is Asam Helmi. I'm a project coordinator in Online Petroleum Academy, Egypt team. The target of this presentation is to introduce OBA software training plan in August and September. I'd like to mention before going to the software training that OBA has conducted a wonderful, successful summer internship program in July 2020 for a group of excellent engineers from different countries and universities from Lebanon, Pakistan, and other countries. This internship program was for 1 month, 4 hours per day for two softwares, Prosper and OFM. Daily assignments was conducted through the internship program, as well as projects and many of case studies. And we have fun also. This is a selfie for the Prosper and OFM courses from the discussion during the webinars and the internship. We also got very hopeful and good feedbacks from our participants in the internship, from Fatin and Harris and Kanza. Thanks to all of them. So going to our software training plan, OBA is introducing two softwares for August and September. Those two softwares are Sapphire and Gap. Sapphire is from 24th to 29th of August, and Gap the second week of that, which is from 31 of August to the 5th of September. The duration of for each one of these courses is 60 days, including 1 day for projects and the rest, which is the 40 day. Each day is for 3 hours, and there is also assignments for each day of the courses. The cost of the course for Sapphire and the Gap is $125 per course. And if you are registered for both courses, you got a discount. You will pay only $225 only. What you learn from the Sapphire course, you will learn a lot about the pressure transit analysis, the different types of pressure testing and flow regimes, the divisivity equation, how to perform QA, QC for the pressure data, and different testing, well testing for the fracture reservoirs, as well as well test design considerations, and more of them, which is not covered here in the slide. What you will learn from the GAP course, you will be able to build a GAP model for the different network analysis, like such as a water injection network, production network for natural flow, ESB or gas lift, also for gas injection networking. You will also be able to match the pipeline correlation, perform networking, networking solving, and also perform network optimization and predicting on gap, performing prediction on gap model. We are so sorry for what happened for Lebanon in the past 2 weeks. So we in OBA are so supportive to people during this crisis in Lebanon. So if any one of the students or engineers in Lebanon wish to join us for these, for one of those courses or both of them, we make a huge discount for them. They can pay only $50 for one course and $90 for both courses instead of $225. Not only for Lebanon, we are supporting people from all over the world. If you wish to have a big discount, so please invite your friends and join us and enjoy the group discounts. As the number of the participants of the group increase, you can get much discount, which is for about $70 for the course instead of $125. How to apply for this training courses? Omar, my colleague, will send the link for the application form in the chat. You can also chat to our WhatsApp number or send us a message to any of our social media platforms, and we will be very happy to answer your questions immediately. I'd like to thank all of you, and thank you to to Engineer Sam Aksar for joining us for today. And over to you, Omar, to start the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Isam. You can find the link of the form and the chat. So please, you can fill it if you're interested in the courses. And just a few simple rules before we start. Please use your full name in this meeting, because we will take it into consideration for the attendance. And the questions will be at the end of the session. So please keep your questions, and in the Q&A session, you can put them in the chat, and Engineer Sameh will answer them. And after the meeting, a feedback form will be sent. So please make sure to fill it in so that we can improve in the future. And now I would like to welcome Engineer Sameh Saqer, who is the doctor and senior lecturer of geophysics in the University of Alexandria. He has worked for Petroleum Geoservices, Schlumberger, RWA DAA, Icon Science, Blada Energy Partners, Adax Petroleum, in addition to teaching in different universities in Egypt. So now I would like to welcome Engineer Sameh to start. Engineer Sameh, you're muted, so please unmute your microphone.
Okay, thanks a lot for such welcoming. I really appreciate it. And definitely my deep service for people, for our brothers in Lebanon. And we will start quickly into the subject. It's about exploiting the potential of the exploiting the full potential of onshore Nile Delta field using QI. QI is stand for quantitative interpretation, simply, which is rock physics and seismic inversion. So what is inversion? Simply inversion, which we already have seismic. If we have like a concession and we wanted to this concession is already has seismic acquired and processed. So I need to know what is the distribution of lithology fluids. If I go by drilling wells, it will cost me lots of money. So the other idea is that let's assume I have like one well or two wells. So I know the different property at each well location. However, in between, if there is a seismic which covered the area between them, so I can use this seismic to extract the petrophysical properties from this seismic. So what I do that I just use the seismic, I invert the seismic into the impedances, acoustic impedance and shear impedance. And from acoustic impedance, shear impedance, I can get different attributes like loss ratio, Poisson ratio, etc., and use it as a discriminator to get the fluid distribution, lithology distribution, porosity, etc. So it's a very powerful tool. It's decreasing the uncertainty to a huge limit, and it's really adding value to it by eliminating the risk decreasing the risk of drilling a dry well. So let's go okay. So forward, the normal way is the forward modeling, which means that I already have the density curve. I have the velocity curve. The product of velocity and density is going to be acoustic impedance using the reflectivity law, which is acoustic impedance 2 minus acoustic impedance 1 over the summation of them. This will give me the reflection coefficient or reflectivity. Then from the reflectivity, I can convolve with the wavelet, and this wavelet will give me the seismic trace. This is the normal or the forward modeling. In the inversion, I go the other way around. I already have the seismic, and I, from the seismic, I go back into the acoustic impedance. Of course, other people, some schools of inversion can say that, yes, we can go to density. It's depending on the using accurate shirt, three accurate shirt equation, three elements, or accurate shirt two elements. Or three terms, or and two terms. The thing that I am not pro density inversion, because density is very critical, very sensitive to any change in lithology or fluid content. So, and even it's linearly changing. I mean, if it's, for example, let's assume that there is a 10% fluid saturation, the density will behave in a way which differ from if we have like fluid saturation 20%, 30%. I mean, density is very, very sensitive. So I even saw just one case, one successful case, and it was very small area with a huge number of wells. So you have more control of the density. In addition, of course, it needs long offset. So this is one of the requirements of density inversion, but still, I'm not pro the density. So I just go into impedances. Of course, I just go to density, but I don't use the output inverted density. I don't use it. So again, why inversion? One of the DHIs, the direct hydrocarbon indicators, is the bright spot. What does it mean, bright spot? When you find like something bright compared to the, I mean, the event is really bright compared to the surrounding seismic data. So in each these four pictures, there are bright spots, and it's always when you, and the seismic, when you see bright spot, it reflects the presence of hydrocarbon, oil or gas. So, okay, if I go with that, let's go for the second one on the left. It's very nice bright spot. This bright spot, ladies and gents, it's coming due to the contrasting acoustic impedance. Simply, there's a, if we have two layers, layer which has low acoustic impedance and another layer of high acoustic impedance, there's a contrast between these two layers is gonna be very high. So that will lead to these bright spots, okay? Okay, so the second one on the left, if I assume it's bright spot, but is it related or a result of fluid effect or lithology effect? So if we reveal it, it's simply igneous intrusion. Igneous intrusion, as you know, so you will find that there is a igneous rocks, the velocity will be very high, which will lead to acoustic impedance will be very high. So there's gonna be contrast in acoustic impedance between the igneous intrusion and the surrounding area. It will appear to me as a bright spot, but it's not related to the fluid effect. It's a lithology effect. So this is one of the things that we need to know the geology of the area we are working on. It's not a matter of like running inversion and just take the result and go on the trail. It's all about integration. By the end of the day, geologists, geophysicists, different domains. Our assignment or our main work by the end of the day is to minimize uncertainty. So we have to integrate all these tools in order to minimize this uncertainty. Just not taking the inversion result only, no. Integrated with the seismic interpretation, with the paleontology, what is the desertional environment, etc., etc. So, and by the end of the day, you get into the decision based on the how reliable is it? Like, okay, if I drill 80% or something, I will find hydrocarbon. So that would be agreed. Okay, so I will go for it. But if it's low probability, so I will. Keep it for later. I mean, I will prioritize my different locations. Okay, if I go for the second one, which the first one on the right, it's top over pressure. There is a over pressure due to like compaction, for example, So due to compaction, there's gonna be pressure is gonna be high, the velocity will be high, hence the acoustic impedance will be high. It will lead to the same result. Gonna be high contrast in acoustic impedance related lead to this bright spot. So not every bright spot related to fluid effect. Second one, they write it's bright spot. It's not that bright, however, it's a bit bright. It's brine sand. Okay, I mean, but some people would take it, okay, this is a bright spot, let's go, let's drill it, and you will find hydrocarbon, but this is a brine sand. So we have to do some analysis before we go for inversion. And last one, which is the first one on the left, this is my gas sand. And one of the main properties which I should know about is the polarity. When I look into the seismic section, I have to know what is the polarity, simply which is representing the increase in acoustic impedance. Is it the peak or the trough? And is it the red color or the black representing the increase or decrease in acoustic impedance? For example, in this gas sand, if this red color representing the increase in acoustic impedance, so it's not gas anymore. This is not a reservoir. But here it's the red represents the decrease in acoustic impedance because the presence of fluid lead to drop, a huge drop in the velocity. So it leads to low acoustic impedance, and that's what we see in the gas sand. So this is a point we have to put in our mind, the polarity, one of the main stuff which we should remember. Okay, so now, okay, are we ready to go for inversion and run seismic inversion? Okay, somebody said yes. So did you know what is the characteristics of your reservoir? Did you know what type of inversion are you gonna run and why? Did you know how you're gonna, okay, if you run the inversion, how are you gonna interpret it? How are you gonna interpret this? The results or the output from the inversion. All this stuff you cannot do it without running a rock physics study. It's a must. You must run rock physics study before seismic inversion. Why? Because based on this, you will know whether it's. You will know what type of inversion you got, what type, the characteristic of your reservoir. You will know, you will be able to determine what type of inversion you should run. Is it, I mean, if we're talking about deterministic inversion, should we go for post-stack inversion or pre-stack inversion? Okay, if we go for pre-stack inversion, for example, what discriminators which we should use? I mean, what attributes? Should we use only acoustic impedance? Should we use acoustic impedance with velocity ratio, Poisson ratio, lambda rho, mu rho, there are many attributes we can use. So which one to use? Which one can separate? This is the point. So we'll go through this rock physics study. So as a introduction about rock physics, what is rock physics? And I will make kind of quick comparison between rock physics and petrophysics. As a name wise, they are the same. Rock physics and petrophysics. Petro is a Latin word which means rocks. So rock physics and petrophysics, name-wise, it is the same. However, and even in the definition, both are the science which concern with the study of the physical properties of rock. Okay, so where is the difference? The difference is in the target. What is the objective of each one? The science which concern with the study of physical properties of rocks, in order to get the lithology volumes, fluid saturation within the well, within control point, which is this well we are working on. I mean, the one well, it's considered as a study for petrophysics. So the petrophysics are looking to well by well. However, for rock physics, it is a science concerned with the study of physical properties of rocks and its effect on the wave propagations result. So the difference here is the objective from each one. And of course, rock physics look into the field, not look into one well by one well. It's look into the field. Okay, based on this, rock physics, in addition, it integrates different domains. I mean, we use, for example, VSP. We use surface seismic. We use some production data, some reservoir parameters. It's integrating different stuff to get the rock physics study done. So what is the main factors which affecting the rock physics? It's porosity, rigidity, and compressibility. Okay, what does it mean? Porosity, we all know what is the porosity. We know it. I mean, in order to give you like an example about what is porosity, rigidity, and compressibility. Let's assume that you have two rock units, okay? One rock unit has the same properties as the balloon, and the other has the same properties as this Coca-Cola or Pepsi one. Let's say that I'm give you these two units. I wrap up this Coke. I put a material inside it, and they put a material inside the balloon. Can you identify the material inside each of them? And when I say identify the material, I mean identify the state of the material, whether it's a solid, fluid, gas. So can you identify it? Simply, it will be, you cannot say shaking it or something like this because it's rock unit. It's like it's already within a layers. So you cannot shake it, nothing. But what you can do is you can compress it. You can try to compress it. So let's assume regarding the balloon, if you try to compress it, you will be able to identify what is inside the balloon. Is it air, gas? I mean, is it hydrocarbon as a fluid? Is it solid material? If you compress, just compress it, you will be able to identify the material. However, if you try to compress this Coke, you will not be able to compress it. So you will not be able to identify what is the material, what is the state of the material inside. And this is the point of it. We're trying to, in a step in rock physics, which is called the fluid substitution, we're trying to identify the compressibility or the incompressibility of the rock, so we can identify the material inside. And we will show you how we do this. So the main factors which affecting the rock physics is the porosity. Because porosity, if you have high porosity, that means that your material or your rock unit, it's gonna be less dense. Hence, the velocity will be low. This will affect the wave velocity, the velocity of the wave propagation. Low density, so the velocity will be less. If it's low porosity, so it will be high density, so the velocity will be high. Okay, rigidity and compressibility, which we're talking about. Rigidity and compressibility, by the way, are the same meaning. However, rigidity is for the rocks, compressibility for the fluid. It's about whether to be, is it the material is compressed, you can compress it or not. For example, if we're talking about compressibility, water is not compressed. If you put the water in a tank, for example, and you try to squeeze this tank, you will not be able to do it. You will not be able to do it. It will blow out, but you will not be able to squeeze or to compress the water because water is not compressed. However, if you go for oil or gas, no, it's you can compress it. Rigidity is the same, but for the, if we're talking about the rocks, sand, hydrocarbon, sand, limestone, etc., different types of your solution. Okay, so these are the main factors in rock physics. One other thing regarding the rock physics versus petrophysics, the main logs of which rock physicists look into is the acoustic logs, which is the shear, compression and shear velocities, and density. However, for the petrophysicist, the main logs of which he look into is the triple combo, which is the gamma ray, density, neutron porosity, and resistivity. These are the main. Of course, there are whatever advanced tools, but it's around the same idea. I mean, these are the main logs that we're just looking to. Where for rock physics, it's the VP, VS, and density. This is a comparison which we were just talking about, rock physics versus petrophysics. We have rock physics has so many applications, like AVO in interpretation of amplitude variation with offset, time lapse for reservoir monitoring, log generation and editing, pore pressure modeling, fracture modeling, seismic inversion, interpretation, and the interpretation of the seismic inversion risk. Okay, so we will go. Our agenda is going to be data loading, rock physics, and seismic tool tie, and deterministic inversion. So for data loading, we have in this area, in this study, it was, we have two wells. However, the client asked to use only one well, and the other well will be blind as a kind of QC when we use, when we get the inversion done. So, okay, I will put the well over the inverted and compare between the blind well and the inversion result. If there is a match, so inversion result is good. However, definitely the optimum QC for inversion is the drill. Let's say inversion said that there is a high potential to find the hydrocarbon in this location if you drill it. So if you drill this location and find hydrocarbon, this is the optimum QC. So it's ND, the two wells. I have ND-1X and ND-2. These are the KBs, and one of them is deviated, which is ND-1X and ND-2. As we mentioned, the main logs is the density, the P wave and S wave, which is P wave velocity and S wave velocity. They are all available in these two wells. However, density and ND-1X, you will notice that it's yes, but in red color. We will see why it's we do this. The petrophysical evaluation logs, because we also need it, which is, I take it from the client, it's the effect of porosity, water saturation, the volume of shear. And from these logs, I estimate or I compute the volume of sandstone, because volume of sandstone is equal 1 minus the summation of volume shear and effect of porosity. You know that the summation of lithology plus effect of porosity equal 1. So since we know that we have only sand shale and we already have the effective process, so we can get the volume of sandstone. One other thing is computing the hydrocarbon saturation. Hydrocarbon saturation will be effective porosity times 1 minus water saturation. Of course, if I have the effective water saturation, it would be more precise. However, since I have effective porosity, okay, I would go for it, and it will be close. It will not be that far from the real hydrocarbon saturation. So this is indeed H1X. If you remember, I said that okay, that density is there, but as you can see, it's very small interval covered by the density. I mean, in the first track on the left, it's gamma ray, then the resistivity, the deep resistivity. Then this green and yellow, this is the lithology track. The green is shale and yellow sand. Then there's the saturation. This is a fluid saturation track. Where you find red, this is the hydrocarbon. So even the density here, although this was exploration well, but it covered the deeper reservoir. But there is shallower reservoir, density is not covering it. So that was one of the things which we we dropped this well. I mean, we had to use one well to go for. So we dropped this well in D-1X because it has the density. There's no density. And since we use one well, so yeah, somebody can say, why don't we estimate the density? It can be done, but since I'm going to use one well, so I really want to use real data. I don't want to get into so many assumptions during my my inversion process while I'm using only one well. And of course, in this case, I mean, for example, for the offshore Lebanon, this well, which has been drilled. So yes, seismic inversion can be run. So we can get the results of inversion and see the distribution of lithology, etc., as we're going to see here in this case. This is ND-2, the other well. Okay, the interval is the density interval is okay. The density interval is okay. It's covering the whole interval and the lithology is okay. So, I mean, this is the well which we go for it and we use it for rock physics. We have seismic data, different partial angle gathers, six. It's six partial angle gathers. And in addition to the RMS velocity, of course, RMS velocity, we convert it into the interval velocity in order to use it. So this is the area of interest. We notice that in black, this is the RMS velocity, or I mean, the bigger area, which is RMS velocity. The greenish area, which is the seismic angle stacks covering this whole area. And the test area, which is blue, which has these two wells, ND-1X and ND-2, this is the test area which we were allowed to use it and, I mean, display the results of it, but we cannot allow the whole result of it. But it was fair enough. This is just displaying for the gathers over the one well, ND-2 over the gathers. So just to check the data and the location of the wells over the seismic. So one of the things here, which is a weakness point, was the RMS velocity. RMS velocity is was 500 by 500. It might be this is the default, or yeah, it's normal, but when you run for, you want to use it for inversion, so we need to fill in between. Even during the velocity analysis, just automatic filling, so you can use it, because we use the seismic velocity to interpolate the property. So whenever the velocity is high, low, etc., this will affect in the interpolation of our property. So it's important to have a velocity, dense velocity, as much as we can. It would add much value. This is just we're trying to compare the interval velocity, which we converted from the RMS velocity, versus the VP from the compressional velocity from each well. I mean, for ND-1X, you will see that the purple, which is higher interval velocity, it's going with the higher from the log. It's going with higher. And then whenever it's greenish or brownish, which is low, it's going lower. I mean, by the end of the day, it's following the trend. When it's high, when it's low interval velocity, the log, the VP from the well, it's showing low values. And when it's high, showing high values from the log. So this kind of QC for your velocities. And the same for ND-2. So, rock physics, starting by cross-plot analysis. Cross-plot analysis, so we do VP versus density. The VP, which is the compressional velocity, versus density, and color-coded by volume of sandstone. So we will look into the color code, the color bar here. So if I go here like this, so where it's blue and which color code by volume of sandstone. So where it's blue, this is my sand. This which is highlighted by this yellow this yellow circle, or well, this yellow one, and where it's it's reddish, this is shale. So this is shale and this sand. But is this sand whole of it? Is the reservoir? Let's go and continue. I mean, when it's, I do the same cross plot, but color coded by volume of shale, just to confirm. So when it's high, so the purple here, yeah, this is my shale. This is my shale. Then the annotation.
Mr. Samah, do you wish annotation tool?
So I can like highlight or.
Yes, it's in the above board.
Yeah.
It's in the above board view options.
Okay. Yeah. But I used to use, but I video panel for them. It's there's only a remote control. There is no annotation.
Maybe it's not enabled here.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, when it's color coded by volume of shale, you can see that the purple color, which is indicating that this is high shale, and the reddish, which indicating low shale, which means that this is sand. So these two cross plots, it's like confirming that yes. This, which is within the yellow zone or yellow circle, this is my sand, and within the green, this is my shale. Okay, but again, is the whole sand is the my reservoir? So when I do the same cross plot, VP versus density color coded by effective porosity, so I find that okay at sand, I find the highest porosity, which is blue and purple, it's in the sand zone, and even that this a bit greenish, it's in the sand. So this is fine. So this is confirming that this is my zone of interest. And at shale zone, I find that it's reddish, which means that effective porosity, there's no effective porosity. So that's what I'm expecting. When I do the cross plot on the right, which is color coded by water saturation, and this is very, I mean, we can separate here that we find that after I have the whole area, which is within the yellow, is sand. Now I separate it into two circles. One is red, which is this is my gas brine sand. This is my gas sand, and this one is my brine sand, which is which brine sand, which is sand having water inside. So this is my brine sand, and within the green, this is my shale. So now it's not the whole sand is my reservoir or is my zone of interest. There was gas sand and brine sand. So my zone of interest is my gas sand. Then this is color-coded by hydrocarbon saturation. So I find that, okay, this is a hydrocarbon saturation. I find it the blue and yellow within this red. So this is confirming that this is my zone of interest. So yes, so based on this, I can, my zone of interest, which is my reservoir, it's characteristic, it's low density, and it's low velocity as well. However, it's, there is overlapping in the velocity. I mean, shale as well is low velocity. So I cannot rely in velocity only. If I do the same for VP versus VS, it's the same. I mean, this is my sand within the yellow. Then this is my shale within the green. When I go for color coded by volume of shale, the same. It's confirming me that when it's colored by volume of shale, the reddish is the sand, so it's within the yellow circle. But when it's within the green circle, it's purple, which is the shale. So now I estimate the sand and shale, but again, it is the same. when I color coded by water saturation, it turned out that I have brine sand, shale sand, brine sand on the same axis, if I may say, but gas sand is low. And of course, in the direction of this, from like southwest to northeast, VPVS decrease. So that means that which velocity ratio decrease. So that means that my gas sand is of low velocity ratio. This is a calculated by hydrocarbon saturation. So this is my gas sand. It's very clear that I can separate my seismic features, brine sand, from gas sand, from shale. Okay, so one of the things which we do is a flow substitution. It's not done here, but I have to talk about it within the rock physics study. We do flow substitution. Let's say I have the well is dry. So, okay, I wanna assume that if this well has a oil and if it has gas, what would be the behavior of VP, VS, and density in each case? So what I do to get this is to do flow substitution using Gassmann equation. Gassmann equation, of course, I don't memorize it. It's already in the box, so no need to memorize it, just to understand it. So K is the incompressibility, which is the Palko modulus. Palko modulus, which is incompressibility. What is Palko modulus? If I say, okay, if you have a rock unit, let's say, if you have a rock unit, and there's a perpendicular force applying on the area of this unit. So the force over the area, this is the bulk stress, okay? Due to this pressure, this force, there is a deformation happen. So the difference in volume over the original volume, this is the bulk strain. So bulk stress over bulk strain, that would be give me the bulk modulus, which is the incompressibility. So we compute the incompressibility, which Ks is the incompressibility for the saturated rock. It's like, when I have rock and inside it there is a hydrocarbon, for example, so the saturated rock equal. Kd is the incompressibility for the dry rock. Like assuming that you just remove this fluid from this rock, what would be the incompressibility of the dry rock? Then there's Km, which is the incompressibility of the matrix. Matrix, which means the mineral which composing the lithology. For example, if I'm talking about sand, the material is a quartz. Sand is forming of quartz. So what is the incompressibility of quartz? So I put it here. Then there's Kf, which is the incompressibility of the fluid. So this are the inputs of and of course the porosity. And we use here the effect of porosity. Why we use the effect of porosity? Because we apply flow substitution only on the reservoir zone, only in the reservoir zone. Because I don't need to see the flow substitution in shale. It's not gonna add any value whatsoever. I'm talking about sand zone, my reservoir zones. Once I got I compute my the incompressibility of saturated rock, I can compute the VP, and from VP I can compute VS and density. So for each case, if I assume that this dry well has a gas, so I will change the Kf, which is the incompressibility for the fluid, and put the incompressibility of the gas, and see what's gonna be the Ks, the incompressibility of the saturated rock. And from it, I will compute VP, VS, and density. So I will get set of logs, VP, VS, density for gas case. Another set for oil case. Of course, you can model so many. You can decrease the porosity, change the lithology, and see the result. I mean, so many things you can do. But let's stick here to just changing the fluid and see the behavior, how VP, VS, and density gonna behave. Okay. After you get these VP, VS, and dentist, of course, since VS, you estimated from VP, so there was so many effort to estimate VS from VP. There are so many equations, Castagna, Dvorkin, Pickett, so many scientists provide us with different approaches to estimate the VS from VP. One of the things to compute bulk modulus in a more precise way is the loose void boundary, where the whole materials, rocks, fluids, the whole materials is within these two boundaries, loose and void. Loose and void reflect the stiffness and softness. So these are the whole material within it. So I can, based on these two boundaries, I can narrow these two boundaries, like according to my data, narrow them, so I would be able to compute the bulk modulus in a more precise way. Of course, Gassmann assumptions, it's like Archie equation in petrophysics. Archie assuming that we have like porous permeable sand, there's no clay, it's clean sand, the whole system is there, water, oil, and gas. All these, I mean, it's the same here in Gassmann assumptions. It's assuming the utopia. You have the sand, porous, permeable, you have gas, sand, and oil, water, oil, and gas. There's no migration. I mean, the system is closed. Even there's no friction, I mean, the fluid does not affect the hardness or softness of the sand, and this is of course not right. But this is how it works. I mean, when you think about getting equation solving some issue, you're assuming the utopia. Then you start to take this equation and modify it according to the circumstances you have or the system you have. This is the point. Okay, so then for each case, we get VP, VS, and density. If we take them with CDD gases, we can get the AVO signature. These are the main signature, class 1, class 2P, class 2, class 3, and class 4. Of course, class 1 is doing, I mean, this is like y-axis is the intercept, which is amplitude, which is intercept, and x-axis is the gradient, which is varying with the velocity ratio, with the process ratio. It can be expressed in degrees as angle, or it can be expressed the x-axis as an offset. So, okay, so for the amplitude is the intercept is positive and negative. So there's class one, for example, is positive intercept and start to decrease and make phase reverse, but at high angle. And you might find that some people say, no, class one do not do phase reverse, but no, this is class one. In some cases, do phase reverse at high angles. At high angles. This is confirmed. Then there is class 2P, and P also referring to phase reverse, that going from positive to negative. So it's from positive intercept, and at far offset, it decreases and go, and what you mean, like, it's going peak, 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 then trough, 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 trough. So this is phase reverse. Then class 2, it's a negative intercept, decreasing with offset. And when I say decreasing here, that the contrast is increasing. The contrast in acoustic impedance is increasing, which means that the bright spot will be much more bright. This is the same. Class 3 is negative intercept, decreasing with offset. Class 4 is negative intercept and increasing with offset. In general, and of course you have to do analysis, but this is, in general, class 2P, class 2, and the class 3 always indicating to the presence of hydrocarbon, okay? But it's not like, don't take it as a fact, you have to do your analysis, but here in Egypt, in most cases, and lots of cases, especially in Nile Delta, yeah, class three always indication to gas presence. Class 2B and the class 2 indication to oil, depending on heavy or light oil. So give us class 2B and class 2. Class 1 is indication to brine, but this is just case based on cases in Egypt here, but you have to do your analysis. In each, even if in Egypt, you have to do your analysis. Don't take it as a fact. Then, okay, this is, since we do inversion, so we, from inversion, from seismic, we invert seismic into impedance. And from impedances, acoustic impedance and shear impedance, we can get velocity ratio and other attributes. So I did here, acoustic impedance versus velocity ratio. Color coded by volume of sandstone and volume of shale. So yes, I can identify my sand and my shale. It's very obvious. Then when I color code by effective porosity and water saturation, I can identify my zone of interest, which is within the red color in the right hand. Then when I color code by carbon saturation, this is my zone of interest. It's very obvious that this is my zone of interest, which is low acoustic impedance and low velocity ratio. So in this case, when I'm talking about deterministic inversion, which has post-stack and pre-stack, post-stack, the output from it is gonna be only acoustic impedance Q, absolute acoustic impedance. Okay, can I use acoustic impedance only to discriminate between gas sand and other lithology? I can't, because I cannot draw a line from acoustic impedance and it will to discriminate between gas sand and shale, because shale also is lower acoustic impedance. So it will grab shale with it. So I cannot use acoustic impedance only. I have to use another discriminator. So I can use velocity ratio. Now I can, if I said low acoustic impedance with low velocity ratio, it will get me the, my zone of interest. So now I know the characteristics of my reservoir. So I'm now able, and I can able to discriminate my reservoir very easily. This is at low resolution. Of course, I do this cross plot, and when I do like three polygons, the red polygon, which referring to the zone of interest, my gas, the blue polygon, which is the brine, and this gray polygon is the shale. And I can see that, okay, this the gray is in the shale. As you see the lithology track is shaley in front of the gray color in the logs. The reddish, which is a gas sand, in front of the gas, and the blue, which is the brine sand, it's in front of the sand where there is totally the track of water saturation, which is the third track, is water. I mean, this is brine sand. Okay, so it's efficient. Now, okay, I can discriminate at log resolution. So, okay, I need to go for at seismic resolution. So I have to, because logging tools are running in like 40 to 50,000 hertz. However, seismic, you're talking about 40 hertz, 50 hertz. So there's huge difference. So I have to minimize or cut, apply filter, frequency filter to the logs and see, okay, whether I can separate at seismic resolution. So when I apply high cut filter, so I still can get the shale, gas sand, and the brine sand. I still can get it. I can separate. This is at seismic resolution. So this is definitely, I can go for seismic inversion, and I know that it will add value. But I will go for pre-stack inversion, because pre-stack inversion will give me the output acoustic impedance and shear impedance, and I can get the velocity ratio as a discriminator. So I can use acoustic impedance and velocity ratio as two discriminators. But post the stack inversion, acoustic impedance only, no way. So now I managed to know my reservoir characteristics. I managed to know that inversion will add value, that the type of inversion I should go for it is deterministic inversion, sorry, is pre-stack inversion. And that's what I'm gonna do. So this is blocky modeling. We're trying to see based on, I mean, if the gas sand, if the effective porosity is bigger than 8% and water saturation less than 70%, so put it as a gas, if the effective porosity is bigger than 8% and water saturation bigger than 70%, so both it as a water sand, and if it's the effective porosity is less than 8%, so both it as a shale. So that's what we get here based on these assumptions. And we use Helterman equation to estimate the signature, synthesize the AVO signature. So the blue, we would shale over brine sand. It gives us class one. And even it make phase reverse because at before 40 degrees was like at 37 degrees, something or 38 degrees. There is a phase reverse. So it gives us class one in case of shale over brine. But shale over gas, it gives us around class two, which is in orange. This is class two AVO class two. So synthetic modeling, this is versus seismic data. It's both, they are both the same. I mean, the last two tracks, one from the well and one from the seismic. So it's the same. So which indicating that we are on the right track. This is also near on the right, on the left is the near angle stack. On the right is the far angle stack. So we can see that on the far angle stack, the bright spot become high. I mean, it's higher than the near angle stack. The amplitude become here it's in the far angle stack become high. The bright spot become much more bright. Also, this is a slice time slice. So if you near angle stack versus far, so the intensity of far angle stacks here is in far angle stacks is higher. This is intercept versus gradient projection. This is polygon where we take class two and the class three, which is indicating to the hydrocarbon. And we see when we take this polygon and at the overlaid on the seismic. So this is my gas at this well at NAD-1X. This is my gas in this red color. Here is as well at ND-2. So we run extended elastic impedance, but I guess I will have to go quickly. I mean, this is extended elastic impedance where we use rotation. It's a modification for Chouier equation in a way that to make it as a function of chi angle. So we see the best rotation angle to find the lithology, to delineate the lithology, the porosities that delineate our base, our bay. So so this is the case. So this is the near angle on the left hand. This is just the near. When I apply the extended elastic impedance for negative 90, this is, I'm hearing delineate my bay. So everything on the left hand, it seems like, okay, all these are bay, of course not. So when I do the extended elastic impedance for minus 90 angle equal minus 90, so this is my bay. When I go for 27 degree, this is exactly my reservoir. I go for my gas here. This is my gas here. This is my gas zone of interest on the left hand. So it's EI, extended elastic impedance. It's technique PP come with it. So it's very powerful. One of the things that seismic resolution, I have to check it. So we find here that the peak frequency, the peak, which is the highest. In this one, it's corresponding to 15 hertz. So 15 hertz, if I find that 15 hertz is a low frequency, especially if I have the velocity of the sand is around, the average velocity is around 2750. If I divide the velocity over frequency, it will give me wavelengths. So it will give me around 170, 180, something like this. 180. If I divide 180, the wavelengths over 4, it will give me the tuning thickness, which is 45 meters. Which means that any layer below 45 meters I will not be able to resolve it. It will be combined with each other. I mean, two layers will be combined with each other. Below 45 meters, I will not be able to resolve it. So, and this is due to the low frequency content. So seismic tool tie, we extract wavelet, statistically wavelet from the seismic. We start to do seismic tool tie. So this is before and after, before and after. This is no, I mean, there was there's a good match for NED-2. Then before and after for NED-1X, this is before and this after. It's before and after. So, and with high correlation around 86%. So this is a very good result. Then we go for seismic data conditioning by checking the well versus the seismic. It gives us the same signature, AVO signature. So we don't need any alignment. Sorry, we don't need any like amplitude scaling or something like this. Here as well, just to confirm this point, that the actual and the model signature versus the actual from the well, so they are both taking the same signature. Even one of them is due to it's coming from the logs, so it seems a bit harsh, but by the end of the day, it's, you're talking about class two. So we are following the same trend. These are the extracted wavelets from the, because we have six angle stacks, so we have six partial angle stacks, so we have six wavelets. We try to see whether there's this alignment. This is the, on the left is the row, and this after alignment by taking 600 millisecond window, two windows, each window has 600 millisecond, but there was no difference. We tried changing the window lengths, four windows by 300 millisecond, still nothing. Even eight windows by 150 millisecond, still nothing. So 12 by 100, nothing. So by the end of the day, this alignment is not needed. I mean, angle dependent scaling, we don't need scaling. We don't need frequency filtering. We don't need this alignment. By the end of the day, seismic data is good enough to go for the inversion. So we build, I said in the beginning that there's a model-based inversion. So what does it mean, model-based inversion? We build a low-frequency model. Seismic, which is in red here, okay, it has its frequency spectrum, but at the low component on the left, it's at low frequency, very low frequency, it might be multiple, might be, it's not reliable. So to compensate for this low component, I take it from the logs. I take the log and I apply harsh frequency filter. So I make the log like just take the frequency which is from 0 to 10 hertz. So I would take this green. So the output from the inversion, it will be this red and the green. So it will be a higher, it's not higher frequency. I extend the frequency spectrum. So this is the initial model. As we're gonna see, this is the horizon interpretation, the two interpretation, which is the top ceiling and the base reservoir. And this is where this log is the water saturation. So where the log is low water saturation, which you have gas. So this is your hydrocarbon. So this is initial model without velocity rigging. This is with velocity using the interval velocity to extract your property. And here you start to see some features. Again, this is the wavelet extractions. We start to constrain our model. This is a correspond between the logarithmic of acoustic impedance with the logarithmic of density, and another one, logarithmic of acoustic impedance is the logarithmic of shear impedance. And this is the sensitivity of our inversion parameters to check what's the optimum parameters. And then inversion analysis and see how, if we run the inversion, how be the result. So it grabbing the blue versus the red. it's grabbing the trend in a very, in an excellent manner. In the last track where it's like reddish lines, everything has been resolved in a way that you cannot see continuity or something like that. Reflection that there's no something remains here. It's very clean, which that inversion doing is in an excellent result. Of course, in this well in NAD-1X, due to the small interval which in within these two yellow lines, because the density, if you remember, in this well density was covering very low interval. So yeah, it's grabbing the trend, but in general, I mean, the interval is really low, so you cannot really give a judge. So this is the inversion, inverted P impedance here versus the log. I mean, the data between the two white lines, this is log, and behind is the inverted P impedance, okay? This is the inverted P impedance, and you can see correlation, very nice correlation. I mean, purple with purple, blue is blue, and forgive my coloring stuff. And then orange or yellow is yellow. There's an excellent match. And this is with the calibrated well, which is the well which we used in the inversion. So this is the impedance, and this is velocity ratio, the inverted velocity ratio. Also, there is an excellent match. Now, this is the QC. This is, we're showing the result versus the blind well. The blind well where there's no, this well doesn't go with us in the inversion. So there is very good match, yellow versus yellow, and even purple versus purple. Here, the inverted VPVS, so the whole interval, it's giving us, very good correlation. So that would reflect that inversion result was okay, very good. Even using only one well, but it can be done. Then we use Bayesian classification to distribute the lithology and the fluid. So this is in D-2, the distribution of, this is in gray, this is my shale. Then in the gas in magenta color, if is it magenta, I guess. Then the blue or the light blue is my brine sand. So this is distribution of lithology. This is distribution at NAD-1X. And there is a potential here. It shows me potential of hydrocarbon, which on the left, there is a potential of hydrocarbon. This is a cross line between the two wells, across wells. This is the gas probability, and as you see, this is a high potential of hydrocarbon here, and it was not there. So you can, this is a high potential location based on the inversion result. So we can go for it and, I mean, pre-trace this location. Then from seismic, if you see, this is the near angle stack. So if you go to the reservoir, which is the log on it, and I mean, follow the, you see, this is the near, the far become higher. It is following the same signature of my reservoir, from near to far, same signature. So, which this from seismic, I can also confirm that there's a high potential, that there's a hydrocarbon in this location. However, based on extended elastic impedance, which showed our pay, no, I don't see the signature. In this location, there is no signature, same as my reservoir. So here, my pre-stack inversion saying that there is a potential to find hydrocarbon, but extended elastic impedance says there's nothing. So there might be something with the seismic, especially that I know that the seismic has been amplitude scaled. It has been, or offset scaling has been done at the contractor who was doing the processing. So this has lead to misleading. sometimes. So this is the case. So just you have to investigate about this point. So by the end of the day, I mean, the initial model was built using the ND-2, and the other well was left as a blind well for QC. Seismic interval velocity was used to constrain the properties or the interpret the properties away from the well. Interval velocity was widely spaced, as we mentioned in the beginning. It's kind of weakness point, but we managed to use it in a proper manner. The inversion was a sensitivity to inversion parameters. We tested and we used the optimum parameters. Inversion results both for the calibration and the blind well was very good compared to actual logs. Patient classification showed us the probability of gas distribution, etc. So it's very good. The inversion tool is a very good tool for minimizing the uncertainty. Now I got the gas probability. Of course, if we saw the whole data, think of it that the whole cube, and you find that the distribution of gas along the whole cube. So you can see, okay, where is your potential location, which if you drill, you will find there is a high potential to find the hydrocarbon, because you cannot say 100% there is a hydrocarbon. No way, under whatsoever, no way to say 100%. Yes, we're minimizing the uncertainty. However, it's not to zero. There will always be some uncertainty, but depending on, okay, to what percentage? It's like you're thinking about 80%, you're going to find hydrocarbon. So, okay, I will go for it. Definitely, I will go for it. So, yeah, so this is the case study. Of course, this case study has also a stochastic inversion, but I guess the time wouldn't allow us to go through it. Even extended elastic impedance, I just go through it quickly. I hope that it add value to you. I hope it's... it enlighten your mind, broaden your mind, and really add value to you. Thanks a lot for your listening, for your patience, and hopefully I wasn't supporting and delivering the message. Hopefully my message delivered. Thanks. So Q&A and many thanks.
Okay, Engineer Samah, we have some questions. The first one, can we calculate VS from existing VP to be used in the inversion, and does it improve the end result? Does it improve the end result?
Oh, okay. Definitely we can, as an answer, I just getting to a slide where I show you, definitely you can estimate the VS from VP. And this is, for example, just a list of a different equation where we can predict VS from VP, and it definitely will add value. Because if you don't have VS, so you have only VP and density. So you cannot go for pre-stack inversion. You only have to go for post-stack inversion, which you will get acoustic impedance on. If you don't have shear, so you must go for post-stack inversion. You don't have any other option. So definitely, if I'm able to predict the VS, that will definitely add a huge value. And there are so many equations to predict VS from VP.
Okay, second question. Is bulk modulus or incompressibility calculated by the perpendicular stress and strain or the volumetric stress and strain?
Perpendicular. Bulk modulus, the incompressibility that is based on the perpendicular force or perpendicular force or pressure, whatever, applying on the area. So it's, and this is why, I mean, the difference if we say, okay, what is the difference between bulk modulus and shear modulus? In bulk modulus, the force is perpendicular. In shear modulus, the force is tangential to the surface. So as an answer for your question, it's a perpendicular bulk modulus or incompressibility. It's perpendicular force.
Okay, third question. Class 1 AVO is also an indicator, gas indicator, but with different or deeper depth of burial, but not brine. Is that right?
Well, I cannot say that, okay, class 1. I mean, I saw it in a case that class 1 was indication for gas. Yeah, but don't take it as a, like a, if you find class 1, okay, this is a gas. No, you have to do your analysis. As I mentioned, for example, I said that class 3 is indication for gas in Delta, in Egypt, Nile Delta. But still, I have to do my analysis and check that, yes, my is the presence of gas will give me class 3 AVO signature or not. So don't take it as a fact, you have to do your analysis and check. For example, if you have gas, what going to be AVO signature? If you have oil, what's going to be the signature, etc. But do not take it as a fact.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the next question is, what does the presence of the brine spot indicate?
What does the presence of brine?
Brine spot indicate.
Bright spot indicate.
Brine, he's saying brine.
Brine? No, brine means water. Brine is nothing. It's called bright spot. Brine is, which means that if we have, mm-hmm. for example, brine sand, which means that sand filled with water. The porosity, the pores is filled with water, 100% water. So we call it brine sand, brine. Brine reflecting, it's water sand. So it's not, there's no brine spot. It's a bright spot, bright, which is like shiny. So this is, as this is light, which is the, yes, here you can see that the bright spot is compared to surrounding. You will find that there is a bright one is very strong. Very strong amplitude compared to weak around it. So this is a bright spot, and it might reflect the presence of hydrocarbon, and it might be a lithology effect, as we saw that in the second one on the left, it was igneous intrusion. There might be overpressure, and they show you as a bright spot. But so you have to do your analysis to check whether it's a lithology effect or fluid effect.
Okay, is only one well enough for doing the inversion and another one for the blind test?
Definitely, the more you have, the more wells you have, the more reliability your results will be. However, I mean, the client asked to use only one well. So yes, you can use one well because and to interpolate the property, you use the stacking velocity, which is you use RMS velocity and you convert it to interval velocity, and we use this interval velocity to interpolate or populate the whatever property. So it's interpolated based on the higher velocity, low velocity, intermediate, etc. So it puts you the values like high, low, medium, etc. So yes, you can do it. And in this case, we saw it and it gives us excellent results. So yeah, you can do it. But the more wells you have, definitely the better results or the more reliable you will have. Reliability, yeah, will be higher.
Okay, for inversion, do you need the logs to cover the whole well depth or only around the reservoir section? And does it improve the inversion results if we have full length logs?
Okay, I need logs to cover the reservoir interval and the other interval. So the other interval. Why? So I need to know the contrast between the difference. I mean, at the reservoir interval, how it behave, and at non-reservoir interval, how it behave. So I would. Because I need even the interval which is not in the reservoir, I needed to constrain my model. At some stages, I needed to constrain my model? I mean, if I, oops, I thought sharing. I need it. I mean, it has to cover the reservoir interval and the interval which is not reservoir. I mean, shale. Let's say if we have shale and sand. Okay, I need to have shale and sand, but it's not necessary to be the whole well. Not necessarily the whole well, but the reservoir definitely and part of non-reservoir interval.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If we have a thick salt interval affecting the seismic data, can we perform seismic inversion?
Sorry, again, if we have a
thick salt interval affecting the seismic data, can mm-hmm. we perform seismic inversion?
Okay. This question, definitely it's a good question, but yes, the salt definitely it absorbs the energy, seismic energy. So this is destroying the seismic the seismic event frequency. It leads to some weaknesses. However, it depends whether you can separate it, whether you can image the seismic inversion. Now can be done in depth domain. So in depth domain you can. Compensate for this the presence of salt, so it can be solved. So it depends on how much is the damage in the seismic data. It depends. I mean, you check your frequency, you check you do your rock physics study and see whether your seismic will be your based on rock physics, you will be able to separate the reservoir from non-reservoir at seismic resolution. If you can do it, so okay, inversion can be done even with the presence of salt. You have to do your analysis, your rock physics study. It's a must.
Mm-hmm. Which software do you use to compute your inversion and AVO processing?
Well, there are so many softwares. In this case, in my case, I was using Hampson-Russell software. It's Hampson Russell for CGG. There is RockDoc, for example, for Icon Science. There is JSON, but also for CGG. There is Petrel, Schlumberger. There is QI for Lomina Geophysics. I mean, there are so many packages in the market. So it doesn't matter what software you are using. I mean, as long as you're capable to handle the software, you know how to use it. Because, I mean, allow me to say this equation, rubbish in, rubbish out. So it's not, you can run inversion and you will have very nice colors. It's very nice colors, but it's useless. So unless you have that technical background in your mind and you can deal with the software, so you can use whatever software you know it.
Okay, last question. Does the high amplitude give the high probability of prospect?
High amplitude give high probability,
Does the high amplitude give the high probability of prospect?
Okay, let me say it in this way. When we look into a seismic section, okay, guys, seismic section as a y-axis is the time, okay? And the x-axis, which what you saw in front of you, it's amplitude. It's contrast and amplitude, okay? Just simply contrast in acoustic impedance, so, which is leading to the amplitude, higher or lower. So when you're saying high amplitude, it might be you might find there's a, for example, there is a carbonate, for example, you have limestone. In my case, for example, in this case, for example, if we saw the cross plots, we have this brine sand of high acoustic impedance. The brine sand is of high acoustic impedance. So why Bryant sand has acoustic impedance? Because it has some carbonate, some lithification by carbonate. So high amplitude just reflect, there is a hard rock here, hard rock. It's not, you're looking for, if there is, for example, high amplitude and the surrounding is low amplitude, so there is bright spot. So okay, now I can see there is a bright spot. Okay, this bright spot related to fluid or to lithology? If it's to fluid, so definitely okay. It's hydrocarbon. It might be a huge, high potential to be hydrocarbon. So to go for it, yeah. But you cannot say that high amplitude is related to fluid. It's about you have to do your analysis and the check. High amplitude is simply high, simply rock, high rock, dense rock, whatever, dense rock.
Okay, I think we're done with the questions. I would like to thank you, Engineer Sameh, for this amazing session and for answering all the questions in detail. I would also like to thank everyone who attended this session and my colleagues who are working with high efforts to deliver these sessions. And this session will be uploaded on our YouTube channel if you want to watch it again or to send it to your colleagues to watch it. And the certificates will be sent within 1 week on your email. And regarding the upcoming courses, you can see further details about them in the on our social media. So you can follow us on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Instagram. You can also contact us on WhatsApp for further details about the courses. And my colleague Isam sent the feedback form for this session on the chat. You can please fill it in. And we will see you in our upcoming sessions. Thank you a lot, everyone, and goodbye.